So I will start by first admitting that I'm cheating and my presentation is not really about procedural generation per se. It's about a topic that might be related to it, but not about it as a whole. And often when we talk about gaming, what comes in mind first, it's game or level design, it's programming, it's art. But on my end, I'm going to talk to you today about a field that is getting bigger and bigger in the industry, which is game analytics. So I'm Youssef Benzeghadi. I joined Ubisoft a bit more than 4 years ago, worked on a few games there like The Crew or The Division. And for the past 2 years and a half, I've been working on Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands at Ubisoft Paris as the game analytics project manager and lead data analyst, which basically means I'm handling everything about analytics on the project, deciding and designing what we should track about player behavior in the game, up to analyzing those data to leverage some insights about it in the game. So first, if you are not familiar with Ghost Recon Wildlands, it's a military open world third-person shooter game that you can play either solo or up to 4 player in co-op. You play as a nomad with a ghost spec ops soldier, and you have to take down a drug cartel that took over the country of Bolivia. We released the game in March 2017. After 1 year, we had more than 10 million players, and this game is really the outcome of a huge production team effort and of years of production. And what we are going to do today, together is basically going back in time throughout the production timeline of the game, and I'm going to show you how exactly game analytics helped in the making of Ghost Recon Wildlands and the success it has become today, and why, more generally speaking, game analytics should be at the core of any game development, especially AAA. So let's start our story. Very early in the development of the game, we are early 2015. At this stage, we already have some playable builds of our game, but we are totally not ready to release it. And we are already tracking some data about players' behavior in the game. But what we are mostly interested in at this stage was to gather player feedback, and we challenged ourselves in order to create a tool to industrialize player feedback. Why? Because we were going from Ghost Recon Future Soldier, which was a quite linear game experience, to Ghost Recon Wildlands, full open world. And being open world means it will be a huge game, first with the map, it's massive, and with systemic activities and procedural generation, almost anything can happen in those open worlds, and you cannot really predict in advance how player will behave due to emergent gameplay, for instance. So it's no longer enough at the end of a playtest, for instance, to gather insights and feedbacks from your players. We really need a way to be able to gather feedbacks from moment-to-moment actions and gameplay. And we decided to create a tool that was a bit inspired by what was done by Bungie on Destiny 1, something they called contextual feedback. They shared that at GDC 2015. And we had the same idea, and we decided to build a tool a bit more complete than just getting feedback from the player. So imagine that you have a playtest session of your game ongoing, and at any moment, we implemented a feature in the game that allows the player to press a combination of button on the controller or keyboard that allows him to give us a feedback, like press A if you think this moment is awesome, press B if you are frustrated, or X if you are confused. And this feedback can be given by the player at any time, and it's tracked. We know what is the feedback, where it was given. At the same time, during our playtest at Ubisoft, we also record the playtest video. And the first thing our tool we created is able to do is to merge the playtest videos and the feedback tracking data, thanks to a timestamp. And the playtest goes on, and at the end, we are able to directly confront the playtesters with their own feedback, to telling them, "Look, at 5 minutes, you told us you are frustrated. Can you please elaborate and give us more detail?" And the player will give you declarative, much detailed feedback that we take and put in our tool as well. So in the same place, we have the feedback tracking data, actually any other kind of relevant gameplay tracking data if we want, the playtest video, and the actual detailed declarative feedback from the playtesters. And the end result of this is a very powerful dashboard that looks like this, where we have for all Ghost Recon Wildlands playtest, all player feedbacks we gathered with this tool. And since we are linking both the feedbacks data and the videos, In this dashboard, you can directly click either on the textual feedback or on the map, and it will trigger directly, just below in the same dashboard, the related moment where the feedback was given by the playtester. It's something we call the feedback logger. It's the outcome of a huge collaboration between multiple teams, notably the analytics team and Ubisoft Paris user research team, and of course the Ghost Recon Wildlands production team. The feedback logger was first used on Ghost Recon Wildlands, and since then we moved it to multiple projects among Ubisoft, like The Crew 2, Steep, or Mario plus Rabbids Kingdom Battle, for instance. So how this can help when it comes to a world that has been procedurally generated? I have a small video example to show you. This is a playtest. Way before the release of the game, the player is wandering, sorry for the lagginess of the video, on a mountain, and at some point you will see he's gonna be stuck because no one never tested this location for real with navigation. And what he's going to do, and spontaneously they all do that actually, he's going to give us a feedback telling us he's frustrated. And since this is tracked, we have the exact position, and we can then later act on it to come to this region of the world, and then have a level designer actually modifying the area so it's no longer an issue. Next, let's move forward within the production timeline of the game. We are still not ready to release the game, but we are ready to give it to the hand of players in real-life situation with what we call the pre-launch live phase. The most known about are closed beta or open beta, for instance. For Ghost Recon Wildlands, the first one we had was held 6 months before launch. It was exclusively done on PC. We had 23K plus players under NDA, and they all played in real-life condition. And during this technical test, we were able to track a lot of data, which ended up in a lot of insights that we were able to prioritize and started working on them to make a better game before release. For instance, we saw that the difficulty of the game was felt as unbalanced. Not only the missions were very easy to complete, even those that were supposedly taking place in the hardest area available in this technical test, that we saw thanks to the tracking of the tracking data of the mission completion. And afterward, we sent a survey to all the players who played this technical test, asking them a bunch of questions, and most of them told us, your game is too easy. So seeing this and the tracking data, we decided to act on this, and we did several things. For instance, we nerfed the starter weapon you start the game with as a ghost, so they are less powerful. We applied some difficulty tweaks, notably the number of times you can be revived by your teammates to reduce it so it's less easy. And we also renamed our difficulty options. It might seem simple, but we saw some discrepancy between the difficulty actually played, which was tracked, and what was reported in the survey. And when we released the game, we re-monitored the same thing, and today the difficulty of the game is perceived as just right, so we are very happy with the change we did. But what we were really able to test during this technical test is the co-op system of Ghost Recon Wildlands, which is a huge part of the game. And it was the first time we gave away the game to real players that were able to play in co-op in real live online conditions. In Ghost Recon Wildlands, there is tons of main story missions. And to be able to play a story mission, first you need to unlock it. If I unlocked a story mission and you unlocked that same story mission, it's perfect, we can play together in co-op and we will both keep our progression at the end. However, if I unlocked a mission and you did not, well, we can still play together, but at the end, since you did not unlock it, you will not keep the progression. We wanted to do that to have some story and narrative consistency, so the players must first unlock what they are meant to do afterwards and they know what they are doing. This is what we call the co-op assist, and we assumed it was not going to be a huge thing in the game because we thought players would start at the same time and progress at the same pace. And we were totally wrong because during this technical test, all players were exposed to some extent to co-op assist, and we even had 10% of them who played the totality of their online technical test experience in co-op assist, probably without understanding it. And the fact with this kind of pre-launch live phase, it lasts just a few days. And in that survey we sent, no one ever mentioned progression issues or losing progression in a mission. because it's just a few days and people are mostly interested in trying your game in advance before anyone else and not really about keeping their save for later. So we were a bit worried still seeing those data, so we decided to hold a dedicated co-op assist playtest to see what players would think about the feature. And we let them play during 1 week in co-op, trying to arise some co-op assist situation. And very early during this playtest week, some players started to tell us, I lost my save, which was actually not true because checking the feedback logger videos and tracking co-op data, these guys were actually in co-op assist. So we nailed an issue there. Players thought that a design choice, perceived a design choice as a bug. So we decided to act on it before the release of Ghost Recon Wildlands, and we released the game like this. Today, at launch, regardless if you unlocked or not a mission, everyone can play in co-op and everyone keeps the progression. Seems a bit simple as a change, but remind that we changed that just 6 months before the release of the game, and this co-op assist notion was so deeply integrated in the game code that it took us a lot of effort and time to fix in time, but we were damn right to do it because when we released the game, we had more than 73% of our player base who played co-op at launch. So have we not fixed that co-op assist design flow, most of our player base would have faced progression issue. And that's a huge example of how we can leverage analytics and insights from analytics before releasing a game. And then we are in March 2017 and we are releasing the game. We start to acquire millions of players, gather billions of data. We analyze gameplay features, how they are used, what players are doing in the game, how many of them are finishing the game, etc. And very early post-launch, people comes up and ask the same question, what is the profile of our players? And this question is going to be asked by ton of people, producers, game designers, level designers, marketing, everyone wants the answer to this question, but they do not expect at all the same answer because they are not working at all on the same scope or feature in the game. So is there a unique profiling of players? My answer is no. There is possibly as many clusters, segments, profiles as there are questions to answer. For instance, we might want to segment our player base based on how they are using weapons in the game, based on how they are using vehicles in the game, or based on what they are paying for in the game. At the end of the day, it's the same player base, but depending on how you look at them and with which data, you end up with different profiles answering different questions. And sometimes some questions don't even deserve a clustering analysis like that. Just an overview, big picture analysis of the data is enough. It really depends on the topic. On Ghost Recon Wildlands, we had a handful of questions that we thought deserved a clustering slash data mining analysis. And I'm going to share two of them with you right now. The first one is how do our players play the game? Which basically is a question about their play styles. How do we do that? We take relevant metrics from our tracking that determine how a player plays the game. Are you using a lot the drone in the game? The main character can send a drone to scout areas and mark enemies at any time in Ghost Recon. Are you doing stealth kills? How frequently are you doing stealth kills? Are you killing a lot of enemies per hour or not? Are you marking enemies before attacking them? What is your average kill distance, for instance? These are the kind of metrics that are tracked and describe how you play the game. And using those, we were able to segment our player base in 6 main different playstyles, which are those. First is what we call sniper. This guy basically loves to play with sniper rifle and they love to attack enemies from a very long range distance. We have what we call ghosts. These guys are very stealthy, but they don't hesitate to kill, so they have a high kill frequency in stealth, while the infiltrator, they are also very stealthy, but this guy, the infiltrator, they don't really want to kill people. They tend to mark enemies and they want to find an extra path to avoid them and still reach their objective. Then we have the funny one, B-styles, which usually are the player who start stealth, screw up, and switch to assault, and then rinse repeat. And then we have more assault-like playstyle, like pure all guns blazing guys, and executioner, which are also assault, but very close range with a lot of close quarter and CQC kills. And based on this, now that we know how our players play the game, we can leverage a few stuff in the game, as you are going to see a bit later in the presentation. But next question that we thought deserved also a clustering analysis was what our players are doing in the game. In some way, it's a game design clustering there. And same thing, we took some metrics that describe not how you play, but what you do in the game. For instance, the number of missions you do per hour. And we ended up this time with 5 main groups. Some of them are very obvious, like mission player, which are guys playing mostly missions, and side mission is our game. Rushers, which are also very mission driven, but they don't really invest their time in side missions. They just want to focus on the story narrative ones. Some elite players that basically play everything in the game, notably in co-op. And we understood all of this group, but one, which is the sandbox group there, which we only know about that they are free roaming in our open world, and we have no idea what they are doing in our game. So we tried to understand them a bit better, for instance, by crossing with post-launch survey data, and we saw that they say they love the game. We know by fact with the tracking that they spent a lot of time free roaming, actually more than 81% of their playtime. And in the survey, they all say they love all activities in the game, but when you check the tracking data, they are not playing all activities in the game, so there is potentially an issue. While a mission player is doing 2 or 3 missions per hour, these guys, they are doing almost 0 per hour. We checked also other kind of demographic data to try to better understand them, and it seems this is the older players we have in Ghost Recon Wildlands, and they have a very slow progression. So it does not help either to understand them. And at some point, we thought that this guy, since they were older, they were parents giving away the controller to their children, let them play nothing. And this hypothesis was totally wrong. So how did we solve this and understand what the hell they were doing in the game? That's where user research comes in post-launch, because playtest is not necessarily only before launch. It can be applied during the entire lifetime of your game. And we basically identified among the playtesters who are eligible to come playtest game at Ubisoft who played Ghost Recon Wildlands, and among them who were those sandbox players, and we asked them, as usual, to come and playtest the game. But this time we had no real question for them, we just wanted to observe them, how do you play Ghost Recon Wildlands when you are at home? And we interviewed them to better understand what they were doing, and they all told us the same thing, even though they did not know each other. They are not free roaming in the game, they are role-playing in the game. And based on what they told us, we were able to identify some other metrics we did not thought about before, but that were tracked, to be able to further segment this sandbox group into 2 subgroups. First one is what we call adventurer. This guy, they play Ghost Recon as designed, but they really, really take their time. That's why they have a very low activity rate. While a mission player will do a mission in 20, 30 minutes, this guy, if it takes 6 hours, it's fine. Why? Because they love to challenge themselves by adding extra modifiers and challenges, not asked by the game, but by themselves into the mix. For instance, I'm gonna do this mission by night, only using a handgun, not using a drone, and stuff like that. And then we identified the other subgroup, which we call military simulation fans. This guy don't care at all about the missions we can provide them. They just want to roleplay, creating their own stories with their own set of rules, and they love customization, notably. If they are playing in a snowy environment, they will wear white clothes, even if there is no gameplay impact at all in the game. So how do we satisfy those groups now that we know who they are? For the mission player, for instance, post-launch, we have been releasing regular new missions, but for these guys, it was a bit harder to address, let's say. So for the adventurers, we decided to release post-launch what we called the Ghost Mod, which basically asks you to replay the main campaign of Ghost Recon Wildlands, but with extra modifiers and challenges, notably a permadeath system. If you die, you die. You have to restart from the beginning all again. And when we check who is mostly playing this game mode, it's mostly elite players, our power users, and next, these sandbox players that fits into the adventurer group. And for the military simulation fans, since we cannot really give them cool missions, they don't want to play them, Instead to giving them content, we decided to help them play together because these guys are really into co-op. One of the playtesters told us, we are a co-op group, I'm the sniper of the group and only me can use a sniper, and my friend is the engineer and only him can use the drone, and it's like this. So okay, how do we provide them content then? So we decided to release what we called post-launch a matchmaking mood system, which basically asks players before playing in co-op with random people, what exactly do you want to do? And the mood you can select in that list, they are all based on the game design clusters you saw before. Plus, we added into the mix some exotic options, such as roleplay, which is meant for these guys. And when we released it, first thing we did was to check what were the most used mood. So main story, as expected, it's the main content of our game. And next, roleplay, which is quite cool. And then when we cross this by profile, it totally makes sense. And the number one mood used by the Sandgroups group is roleplay. Elite players, main story, etc. So it makes total sense. And it means we were able to reach these players we before did not know really what they were doing in the game. So that's a huge example of how we leverage understanding of our players to be able to create a new feature for them. And next, let's continue our journey through the production timeline. Even if the game is released, Ghost Recon Wildlands is what we can call a game as a service or live game. We have been releasing regular updates with new content, like the one we released by understanding the player, such as the matchmaking mode or ghost mode. Notably releasing a new cool mission, one involving Sam Fisher from our Splinter Cell franchise and one involving the Predator himself. And 8 months post-launch, we released a brand new game within the game. It's called Ghost War, and it's our 4v4 player versus player game mode. And Ghost War being PvP, it must be a balanced experience, and analytics really help in this department. And we consider Ghost War as if it was its own game, so it even had its own closed beta, for instance, during which we saw that this guy, the Grunt, was not really appreciated by players and was not very enjoyable to play. Ghost War works a bit like Rainbow Six Siege. You have classes you need to pick to play. If one is picked, you cannot take it, you need to take another one. And if all classes you unlocked are picked, you have no choice but to play with a basic class, which is the Grunt. And since when you start the game, you have no classes unlocked by design, you have no choice but to play this guy at least once for your first match. But it was not really a good experience, so not a really good onboarding. So seeing those feedbacks and data, we decided to put more effort on the Grunt. And today he has a new name, a new design, more variety of weapons to choose from. And it's much more appreciated by our players. And once we fixed this onboarding PvP issue, we were able to release PvP for free for all Ghost Recon Wildlands players. And a strong community started to be created around it. And they all complained about one thing when we released it. Thermal vision. In the game, there is an ability that allows you to activate thermal vision while using a weapon. And basically what it means is that if you see something in red, you shoot, pretty much guaranteed it's a player, so you have a kill, and at the end you will probably win. So we were not really convinced it was the truth, so we checked the tracking data, and indeed the win rate when using the thermal vision was above the balance, 54%, but the more concerning part was for some really specific PvP maps where there is a lot of foliage and vegetation. Players thought they were hidden in bushes, but with thermal vision, you are not hidden at all. So we decided to fix that, and today the thermal vision is no longer usable from weapon, only from the drone to spot enemies but not kill them, and just a few classes can use it. But what we are really happy and proud about in terms of balancing for PvP is what we call data-informed level design updates, where we were able to balance our maps thanks to tracking data. This is the quarry map, which is the most imbalanced map we have in Ghost War. Basically, if you spawn up there, spawn A, you have 58% chance to win, which is broken. So how do we fix that? What we decided to do is to provide the PvP team back at Ubisoft Bucharest with some tracking data maps, where it shows them where players tend to die in the map. And these maps are interactive. You can click on those death area and it will show you from where people who died there have been shot from, which allows us to identify over the top line of sight and then act on it to put some more cover or extra 3D assets on the map. And doing this, it helps us bring a bit more balance in the map. Another example is the Institute map. In this map, there is two hostages. One team must defend them. The other team must extract at least one of them or kill the defending team. What first thing we saw thanks to the tracking was what one of the two hostages was a little bit easier to extract. And anyway, same issue there, 58% win rate for the attacking team. So the issue was the attacking team. We don't really need more than that, so no fancy data maps there. And what we did was to change the layout of this PvP map. We moved the spawn point of the attacking team and we brought closer together the two hostages so they are a bit easier to defend. And we monitored the change and we went from the 58% win rate for the attacking team at our title update 12 to 48% win rate for them at our title update 14. So this time it's still a bit unbalanced in favor of the defending team this time, but it's a much, much better experience. And it was really challenging because in Ghost War, the PvP maps, they are not uncrafted. They are based on the procedurally generated open world. And we took the open world map and we said, okay, there it's gonna be a PvP map. Then good luck to balance it. So that's why we really needed those kind of data. So as you saw, we did a lot of stuff throughout the production timeline of the game, pre-launch, at launch, post-launch. And it could be the end of the story, but we want to do something more with Ghost Recon Wildlands and push a bit the boundaries of game analytics with what we call analytics-driven features. This is the classic analytics pipeline, let's say. Your player is playing, we receive some tracking data based on what he's doing in the game, we analyze them, gather some insights, and then we act on it. That's what you saw so far in the presentation. But on Ghost Recon Wildlands, we are now able to do this, where we can take some formatted data or insights and give them back to the game server. For instance, if I know that you are a sniper player, I will just give the information back to the server. And next time you play, we can leverage this information. And instead to talk about assault rifle in the game, for you, we will talk specifically about sniper, for instance. And what we really wanted to push with this kind of system and pipeline was our matchmaking. We wanted to create what we call the Friends Factory. Our goal was to create new friends among our community of players. And first, thing we did was to sit down with game designers and say, okay, we assume players are gonna play like this and like this. It was way before launch. And we make some assumptions, created some fake playstyles, not the one you saw before. And we released these fake assumptions in part of our matchmaking system, saying, okay, if a player is doing that and that, they are most likely compatible together. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it did not work. And in practice, with this first manual version, it created situation like that.
Okay guys, let's go according to the plan. Full stealth. Hey, what the?
So we assumed this guy was compatible with the other guys, but it was not, and it can create chaos in the session, which might frustrate the other players, which might just stop playing, which is of course something we don't want. So instead of doing stuff manually, we decided now to rely on actual player data, and we created with our data scientist at Ubisoft Paris a machine learning model who is taking various data as an input, notably the playstyles you saw before this time, what you are doing in the game, are you often using a microphone or not, where are you in terms of progression in the main campaign? And it uses all of this data to score each player in order to maximize the chance that a couple of players will play longer together and invite themselves to become friends. It's basically a smart dating system based on your gaming usage of the game. And this is used by our matchmaking system now. And how do we test that? Because we are not able to say this half of the room is gonna be based on the system and this half is not, because it would divide our matchmaking queues. So basically we are switching on and off the system to see its impact. And when this system is on, we notice that we have a small increase in terms of playtime between player matchmade together and higher chance for them to invite themselves and become friends afterwards. It's just a small increase, like 5 up to 10 minutes more co-op playtime, but session after session after session, it becomes hours of playtime gained there. And now, what if we use tracking data and analytics not to enhance feature like we did with the matchmaking there, but to give those data back to the players and provide them with a game feature using those data. We wanted to offer, I forgot to mention that with our mood system we released post-launch, now that we know that what players want to do, we will try to add this information to our model so it's even more precise. Next, I wanted to show you how we can use players' data for the players this time, not to enhance a feature, so they can use it maybe to play your game in a different way. This video is a proof of concept of such idea and feature.
Hey, my name is Yosef Benzigadi, Lead Game Data Analyst and Analytics Project Manager on Ghost Recon Wildlands. It's my pleasure to share with you a never seen before in-game analytics-driven feature, proof of concept. As you can see, we managed to re-inject in the game real players' position data. The result is a very precise interactive heat map. Any individual player can see in his world map where all of the players went in our massive open world. Let's select this hotspot and check out what's going on there. The goal here is to gamify players' data in order to drive exploration without overwhelming players with ton of icons on the map. Rather than a mechanic exploration, this helps a more social and organic discovery of our open world. Such technology could also be used before launch by QC teams to check if all regions in the world have been tested.
Cartel network station. Hit the door.
And look at this, a new side mission. How the players discovered it first and generated data that led us here.
So you get the idea. We used basically position data, put them back in the world map of our game, and we wanted to see if players would be able to use that. This used to be a proof of concept. We work on that with Benoit Martinez, who is our lead artist and technical art director on Ghost Recon Wildlands, as well as our data scientist at Ubisoft Paris. And for a long time, it has been just a proof of concept, but we really wanted to push it. And 2 months ago, we were able to release that feature in-game for all Ghost Recon Wildlands players. Basically, they can open the world map of the game as usual, and by pressing one button, they can switch from the normal view to the heatmap view. We applied some more polish on the map. It has now been colored based on the vehicle used when you are roaming the world. And we hope players would use that to play the game a bit more differently than they are used to be. And I was happy to see that kind of stuff on Reddit, for instance. This comment is really cool. You can see detail in structures as opposed to just a black cube on your map. You can make out walls, tents, fences, and other buildings. You can even see where entry points are on buildings. This is a comment from a real player, and it's actually that player who did that map comparison and shared it online. So it's quite cool. And when we are actually checking who is mostly using this feature, we notice that it's mostly used by our infiltrator playstyle group, and they are probably using that to plan in advance from where they would infiltrate some areas based on how players did it as a whole. So it's quite cool. And when you share this kind of stuff to your production team afterwards, start to create a lot of ideas because it means, yes, it's possible to use player data to leverage some innovation in game and level design. And we started to have some crazy ideas like this one. We wanted to invest in what we call data-driven open world production. This is an ongoing R&D topic, let's say. It was ongoing at the same time of that heatmap feature. The heatmap feature is now released in Ghost Recon Wildlands. This is still ongoing, but basically what we did is to train a machine learning model to try to predict where players would go in our open world. To do that, we are using the player's position data from real gameplay, but also the world map of the game and some metadata saying the missions are there, vegetation are there, the roads are there, etc. And then the machine learns and tries to predict where players would go. This is the kind of result we have. This is real data, this is predicted data. And sometimes we can see stuff like this that are not really apparent in the real case scenario. And when we go check in game, what is that? It seems that our model, due to the world layout, thought that player would go there, but in practice they did not, because there is actually nothing there, and players are naturally attracted towards content to play. So we can potentially use this kind of technology to assess before and where player would go in our open world, and then say, okay, we might probably need to add something in this area. Another way we can use that, and it's how we have been trying to use it for the post-launch content of Ghost Recon Wildlands, is to tell the model there is a mission there, even if there is no mission there, and see how players would spread around it, which can help selecting the position of a future mission you want to release in your game, and maybe adapt the level design around it. So this is still ongoing, and the end goal for us is to have a kind of data-driven slash smart level design editor within our engine. So that's my presentation. I tried to share with you a lot of cool stuff that really helped us in the making of Ghost Recon Wildlands, and that's how basically I think game analytics should be applied on a game, trying to understand your player first, gathering insights and acting on it, while also trying to create features based on those insights, or even using player data as an input of those features, like this heatmap. Thank you.